like, no, motherfucker, I don't think I'm better than you, but I operate better than you. You know what I'm saying? I operate like a fucking professional. No, no, it's better. It ain't different. It's fucking better. Like, call it what it is, right? And so sometimes you gotta just tell people hard truths. Like, you operate like a rookie. I operate like a pro. And there's different, like, there's different rewards, and there's different consequences from operating the way we do. Like, when you operate slow and low, you don't get shit from it.
Today we have a very unique episode. The three of us discuss what makes each of us personally angry. And the discussion gets wild, man. It goes into the state of politics. It goes into Donald Trump. It goes into race. It goes into a lot of places that we necessarily don't typically go. But those places we go to are real places and the real discussions. And we do our best to come up with real solutions that we can share with you guys, and real thoughts and real ideas. So this is a unique episode. It's an entertaining episode, and I really think everyone's going to enjoy it. So let's roll into it. What's up, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Business and Biceps. And you better wake your ass up, because on today's show, we're going to freestyle. John said he's like Kendrick Lamar. Are you guys ready for this? Just like him. We're going to freestyle on what's pissing us off. Maurice, I didn't even tell Maurice what we're going to talk about today, but I guarantee he's got something that's pissing him off. So we're going to talk about what's pissing us off. Then we're going to flip it to you guys and deliver some take-home points like we always do on the number 7 ranked podcast in business, currently Business and Biceps on all of iTunes. Of course, it's brought to you by shop.bstseafood.com. And if you'd like 15% off of the fresh East Coast seafood, use BIZBIS15 at shop.bstseafood.com. Johnny, tell them about 2020. 2020 is for photographers. It is for business owners. It's for anybody who has a website or needs to build one. It's a marketplace where you can get licensed photos from excellent photographers so you can build out a gorgeous website. And for photographers, this is a great place to make some extra money. And for people looking to give their website, you know, a 2.0 version, or looking to build a website for the first time, 2020twenty20.com is the spot to go to get photos, because you can't just rip them off Google, guys. You don't have a license for that. So 2020 is a great marketplace, Corey. And I believe Business and Biceps has an offer for our listeners in correlation with them.
Yeah, absolutely. Just like you said, it's 2020.com/biceps. Get 5 free trial photos to deck out your website. Once again, it's twenty20.com/biceps. So check them out. And of course, build a stack at maxeffortmuscle.com. Any 3 products for a hundo and a free t-shirt, and any 5 products for 160 with a free t-shirt. Hashtag what's in your sack, John, Maurice. All right. So this is how we just, no, I know Mo's ready. He's hooked up. He's at the crib.
He ain't got last week.
I wasn't going to say it. All right. So I want to talk to you guys about something that you want to get off your chest. You want to talk about, we can spin it every which way, like we do here at Business and Biceps. I'm going to start with John Fosco first. John Fosco, what in this current time frame, it could be anything, business, personal, worldly, is pissing you off? I want to hear about it.
Man, I Corey, I got 2 things, man. You pick the door, number 1 or number 2.
I will go number 1.
Okay. Number 1 is, and I'm going to preface this, but this could upset some people, but Corey picked door number 1, so I'm going down it. My problem in general, okay, is I care too much about everything. Sometimes I wish I could care less about things. But I am very concerned and upset with what's going on in our country. And I know we don't go, I know we don't go here, but I'm seeing heat on the leader of the free world, and I'm seeing decisions that aren't measured, that have implications that can endanger all of us. I'm seeing involvement in sexual scam. I'm seeing stuff that makes me feel very uncomfortable with the leader of our country. And it keeps getting worse. I'm sorry. It keeps getting worse. And every time I see it, I say, maybe I should stop paying attention to it. But I cannot believe the level at which things are breaking down, at which the rules that this country's been governed by since the founding fucking fathers, like are being ripped apart, and someone is coming in, bullying everybody, everything, changing everything that's been built, and putting Americans, I believe, John Fosco believes, not Business and Biceps, John Fosco, in a vulnerable position that A, we don't need to be in, right? I take things very seriously when blood is spilled, okay? And I also take things very seriously when you threaten the economic functionality of the system that is the United States, the richest country in the history of the world. When you threaten that to protect your own interest, I have a fucking problem with it. I wish I could drop it. I wish I could not think about it. But the fact of the matter is, it keeps getting worse. And I don't know what the fuck to do about it, guys, because I can't do shit about it.
Opened up the fucking can of worms. So, John, here, we're freestyling. So, Maurice, do you want to comment on that, or should we go John door number two?
Yeah, I can comment on it, and I'll also preface it with this, that, you know, in a large part, I don't know how government works, because there's just so much scandal, and there's so much, or put like this, I don't know how it should be working. But I can understand John when he says that when you look at all the scandals that have come up, when you look at the White House, how it becomes musical chairs, and, you know, every 5 seconds you're firing somebody, you're hiring somebody, people are on Capitol Hill being interviewed, and, you know, you just have all this this trivial shit that seems to be taking place, and, you know, this, it seems like constant dick measuring contests that go on. And I can understand how that can be disturbing. Because it becomes disturbing to me. And I was mentioning one day, and I'll get to what he's talking about in a second. But to add on to that, I was just thinking about business in general. And I said, man, when you lose, you know, 2, 3, 4, 5 people within your company, there's some lead up time to bring on new people, tell them what's going on. But that's cool if it's fucking business and biceps, but that's fucking uncool. Right. It's the country. You know what I'm saying? And I just like, you just can't have a level of stability or a level of focus when you got all this stupid shit that seems to be the focal point. And I've never been president, so I don't know what that seat feels like, but I can understand how a person can come to that perspective. Like, yo, like, this shit isn't going how most people would expect the presidency or the leader of the free world to operate or go. And then when you come to talking about just bombing people in general, like that's a whole different deal. And, you know, of course, I was in the gym this morning, and, you know, you look at your MSNBC, then you look at Fox, and then you look at all your other shows that are up this morning, and, you know, everybody has an extreme view. But, like, at the end of the day, like, when you talk about, what is it? I think it was, and correct me if I'm wrong, you dropped 75 fucking missiles on a nuclear plant, and you got the fucking
Syria.
On Syria. And it just like, it's just a, it just looks like a mess on TV. And I don't know. I sound even, it looks like a mess, but I can understand how you can come to the conclusion like this ain't how shit is supposed to be going. And I think everybody feels like that. You're not supposed to have scandals with porn stars. You're not supposed to be firing motherfuckers. You're not supposed to be getting your lawyer's office raided. You're not supposed to be just having these indiscriminate wars with, you know, these Russian allies and all type of other shit. But I feel like this John Fosco, I feel you, and anybody who has a fucking heart, anybody who has a fucking heart will understand that you don't need to be dropping missiles on fucking innocent people. At the end of the day, they're people. I don't give a fuck where they from or what border they cross. It's fucking innocent people that you're just dropping bombs on. And I wouldn't want to be on the other side of that equation where you just got fucking, you know, million-pound missiles. You know, I know I'm exaggerating right there, but you don't want these fucking missiles just coming and blowing up your shit, blowing up your civilization,
yeah,
and blowing up your life. So I definitely, definitely feel you right there.
Yeah. Well, I just want to say one more thing to couple it. There's 2 points. If you want to go, and I'm going to get political here for a second, and attack Assad in Syria because Assad has committed crimes against humanity, and you want to take him out, then you need a strategy, and I'm all for it because he kills women and children. Go take that motherfucker out, but don't bomb him for one fucking day, okay, and then pull back. What kind of strategy is that? You are not handicapping him. You are doing nothing but changing the news cycle so it doesn't focus on something that you want it to focus on. And the biggest point is this. This is business and biceps, right? Trump is at war with Jeff Bezos. He's at war with Jeff Bezos, which affects me economically and many others because Jeff Bezos owns the Washington Post. Well, the Washington Post reports news that is referred to as fake news or whatever the fuck you want to call it. So Trump, with his power, is trying to hurt Jeff Bezos. And he's hurting the fucking Amazon stock. And he's saying, it's putting mom and pop shops out of business. Well, motherfucker, it's the free market. I thought you were the free market capitalist dude of them all. I thought that's what you were. So now you're going to attack Amazon? Because mom and pop shops are out of business? Dude, like, what the fuck? That is the financial fabric of people's jobs, of people's retirement. You can't just pick a fight with them because dude wrote a story, which he didn't even write in his newspaper, that looked bad on you. You can't fucking do that shit. So that's that.
Here's what I'm going to do is I don't really, yeah, I know what I love about it, but what I'm going to do is I don't really talk politics. I'm not versed enough on it. John, I know that you pay way more attention, so I'm glad that you were able to voice it, I think, in the proper manner. What I'm going to do is talk about the takeaways of what's happening. It doesn't matter whether it's the country. It doesn't matter whether it's your business. It doesn't matter whether it's your family. If you have this much chaos going on around you in any situation, it's going to be a disjointed mess. You cannot have this many people in and out. You can't have this many things going on around you that have what I call static or negative problems. You can't efficiently run a business, country, family. It doesn't matter what it is if it's this chaotic. So my whole big point to tying this into business is that if in your life or business, it looks like the motherfucking White House right now, or sounds like it, or is the press is like that is a recipe for disaster no matter what you're doing. And so like what I've always, always tried to do, and I feel like I've done a pretty good job of it in my career, is eliminate all of the shit. Some of it you can't eliminate because it's just going to happen, but I keep it to like the lowest amount of percentage of static and problems and things around me, because these are the things that we've talked about in previous podcasts that take you off the line. So at the end of the day, you got this line and you got an arrow at the top, right? And that's where you're going on your success pattern. But all of these things, banging a porn star or you're firing this person and you're hiring, like it doesn't matter. Like these happen in regular life too for people's businesses. They take you off the line. And every time you're off the line, you're not going up, you're going sideways. And so the takeaway that I've got is it doesn't matter really the situation that we're talking about. It's more about like if you're in your business, like you've got to stay on that path and that discipline stays on the path. And at the end of the day, like if you're going sideways, you ain't going up. Actually, you're going down. And so the chaos that's going on in the country, the chaos that I've seen in previous businesses, none of that shit's positive. And so you need to clear that stuff out and fix it before you're going to get to where you want to go. That's really my point on John, what I think you voiced, which
that's
I'm
a,
glad
no,
you
were listen,
able to
that, that's a
you
great
know what I'm saying?
Point.
Because no, how, can no, you run the, how can you run anything? How can you run anything no, if it's chaos? So that's
a great point, Corey, because what it would be like is you hiring somebody and saying, this person has the utmost respect from me. What they've done in life is amazing. And then 3 months later saying, he's a slimeball loser. Well, forget about the slimeball loser. What does it say about you 3 months earlier calling him the best thing since sliced bread? It says that your judgment really isn't very, very good. And I just want to close it with this, right? I'm not a Democrat, okay? I'm just going to say that. I'm not a Democrat. So anybody who wants to put me in a box for saying what I said, I want to just put that out there. So that's that.
I'm glad you said that, Johnny, because that would be easy to say like, oh, it's just propaganda because he's a Democrat. But because you none of your principles are, I mean, some of them are, but at the most, you're a businessman, which is also mostly towards the Republican Party.
I pay
correct?
Too much
I mean,
fucking so tax to be a Democrat.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay? Well, yeah, I tell you, Johnny, listen to me. I feel exactly what you say. I got Republican and Democratic views. I'm somewhere in the fucking in between, yeah. But I hear exactly. Listen to me. If you ask me, I don't believe people are Republicans or Democrats. I think most people just want like fucking humane shit to go on in this country. I think most people want people to be employed. I think most people want people to carry their weight. And I think people who need assistance should get assistance in many different facets. And I think it's like a small percentage of shit that people argue over that they probably feel the same about anyway. And I just think a lot of shit gets blown out of proportion. But when I sit here and think of Trump, like it made me ask myself, like, what did you expect when you put somebody in business in politics? You know what I'm saying? This is kind of like what you get. You know what I mean? Like in business, you're constantly trying to serve your own best interests. And everything is about yourself. And you don't really understand that until you get into business for yourself. You're always trying to win and make personal victories. And so I think he's just conditioned just to do what he does. You know what I'm saying? Right, wrong, or indifferent. I think like when you're just in business, you're always thinking about how do I win? How do I get a good victory? How do I make this thing work for me? And I would believe like this man been doing business for so long. Like everything is about that. And everything is about him. Like I think politics is truly for people who like their first thing is the people. You know what I'm saying? And oftentimes those people don't come with a great set of skill sets when it comes to business. And I think like that's where things tend to fall down. It's either like you get an extreme guy that's all for the people and the business is fucked up, or you get a guy who's all about the business and the people are fucked up. And so, you know, based upon, I guess, what you're doing in your life, that's who you vote for, because that's kind of like how I feel sometimes. And, you know, if we get a great guy, you know, who can seem to balance the best of both worlds, and kind of walk a fine line in between, I guess that we got a victory. But I don't know. I kind of get like you, John. You know, you ask yourself, like, you know, I feel like just my heart is bigger than them all, because I seem to care about everything. And I think that they say an educated mind makes you more aware. And the fact that you're more aware, you just really understand what's going on. Like if you weren't educated enough to understand how his moves affect the market and affect the economy and affect people's retirement and affect investments and affect all this other shit, it'd probably just go over your head and it wouldn't make sense to you. But the fact that you are educated and see how this affects the larger economy, like it spurs feelings up. You know what I'm saying? And so the more that you educate, the more that you know, they say sometimes the more that you suffer. Like they say, ignorance is bliss. When you're foolish and you're ignorant of shit, like nothing right. matters. You're just blissful. Right. You know what I'm saying? But the more you sort of educate yourself, you know, it's just the gift and the curse of it all, my man. That's all I'm saying.
So, yeah. Johnny, I want to know what's on door number two now. Door number one got us moving. What's in door number two?
Yeah.
door number two is...
I mean, shit, let's go.
Door number two is just... I think I've touched on this in other podcasts. I don't understand. Maybe it's where I live, where if you exit an elevator or walk by someone on the street, it is a social norm now not to have any sense whatsoever of community, right? Like, look at someone. When I look at someone where I live, they drop their head. They don't at least smile. They don't at least say hi. And it's not one person. This isn't a small sample size. This is regions of people. This is age groups of people. And I think I can attribute it to the isolationism that technology has created. But I just think something is really wrong when you see another human being and in passing, you can't muster up a smile or a what's up or a how are you. You don't need to know that. You don't need to know that person, but why not put positive energy out when you have the opportunity to do so? So I don't know if I'm flaming about that, but it's more of like a letdown. Like we got to switch things back because back in the day, to my understanding, community mattered. Like, and motherfuckers knew everyone in their community and there was a sense of pride. Now, motherfuckers don't know their neighbors, bro. They don't know their neighbors, right? It's just like, I feel like something has, and my belief is technology, has separated us so severely that it's just taken away some personal fabric that really matters, I believe.
Yeah, I would, I would 100%, yeah, no, I would 100% attribute it to technology, because people begin to create these cultures through their phones, and they have a whole life and a whole reality and who they look at and who they talk to and who they communicate through text, and just the whole social interaction is structured different. You know, let me go talk to my friends. Let me go talk to people who I'm connected through this device. And I can see that little, I can see the, I can see the internal process. And I know, John, you don't have kids. And I don't know if Cory, if your kids have devices, but there'll be times I'll be in the house and you'll have my lady, she'll be on her phone. I'll be on my phone and my daughter be on her phone. And just basically our attention at probably what used to be pointed towards each other is just driven through the phone, you know, and I don't know. I don't know even if when we start doing it, if we were aware of it, but you know, it's not just a text message. It's not just Instagram or Twitter or Facebook or Snapchat or something. It's like that we've conditioned ourselves to be so locked into this little computer screen that just basic social interaction has basically suffered. And going to get to know your people and socializing, I guess that urge to socialize is satisfied through a different vehicle. And so you feel like fuck people. Or I can tell you this. There are certain people I don't talk to because when I look on the internet, I feel like I know everything about them. You know what I'm saying? I know what's going on. So the sense to, hey, let me pick you up. Let me call you. But technology has definitely affected the country in that capacity. In a good and bad way, but you know, even when you say you don't know your neighbor's names out there, it was two things that popped up in my head. The first one was like, oh shit, like you know, if they put their head down towards John, and I know we going into two conversations that we probably never thought we'd have. If I was in that situation, I would say in my head, oh, she must think I'm black and she's scared of me. Or he's scared of me, so they put the head down. But the fact that you said, I said, okay, Rich, you need to rethink this. So you actually just taught me something. It may have more to do with people not socializing with each other than the fact that you're black and you're a bigger man. So that thing. But the second thing was also, I don't even know the neighbors in my own community. I know we have a police officer that lives about five doors down, and me and him are relatively cool. And we have a guy that I've grown up with, but I couldn't tell you anybody else outside of here. So it kind of made me think to myself, like, how much do I socialize with people? So that's just my two cents on that, but you actually taught me something.
I want to ask something real quick, Mo. Is that really your first thought that would come to mind? Because that's crazy to me, not in a bad way, but just the fact that like I'm thinking about it, like I would would be the first thing that would come to mind to you if you saw somebody doing that because they was scared of you because of your color or your size or that you're a male. And if that's like you're literally like
hell
true
yeah,
first
if I
thought,
was him, I'd be thinking the same fucking thing.
I mean, you are a scary motherfucker, no matter what color you was. No, but
like, but this like here we go. I give it to you like this, and this is something different, but into that conversation. I don't want to lose John's conversation, yeah. Right? I love sure. to run outside, right? I won't run outside while it's dark outside because I'm a black man running outside in the middle of the night. If that makes any sense to you, like if I had my way,
that makes a lot of sense.
I would go jog around my neighborhood. I would run sprints. But at 5 in the morning, big ass black dude with a hoodie on running through the streets, yeah, that can make some people uncomfortable. But this is just real shit. I know, like, even as I'm saying to it, like, I'm not even sure people understand that this goes through people's minds. You know, if there's a white guy running down the street, right, it's a white dude. Every single morning he runs down the street, I'm pretty sure he doesn't think, like, if I'm running down the street, somebody will be in fear or they'll feel uncomfortable if I'm running down the street. You know what I'm saying? But this is, like, real shit. Or, like, when I walk to people or if I talk to people, I'm constantly on the defensive, like, how would they feel because I'm black saying what I'm saying? Like, I'm moving being considerate of other people's feelings. Like, I'm moving, like, just think about that. You don't go outside in the morning and say, if I jog, I'm going to be offensive to somebody. Like, that doesn't even play through Corey's mind. You know,
that's why I just mentioned it, Mo, because it doesn't at all. Dude, that's why I questioned it.
Man, dude, this is a serious daily thing to where you constantly think, like, here we go. I get pulled over in the car in the state of America. We say we don't talk about race and religion, but I don't know why. It kind of like spurned in this way. It's kind of like what came up in my mind. But I got pulled over, and the fact that you've had all these massive ass police shootings, like as I'm getting pulled over, and this is in Arizona because I did a rolling stop. So I hurry up and grab my wallet. I put it on the dash, and this was just like 2 weeks ago. I put my hands on the steering wheel, and I'm like super nervous and super like compliant because I've seen how this thing can go bad and motherfuckers get killed, right? And so as Ashley's sitting there and she's grabbing her phone, I say, look, don't even fucking move because I don't want anything to be construed as anything different. You know what I'm saying? It's how I don't know how you would get pulled over. You're like, oh, let me grab my wallet. Let me do this. But race, definitely how you move and how you act and how you operate or your tone of voice or like making yourself less intimidating to people. You constantly trying to pull back. So you don't make the next person uncomfortable. So I don't know like how he got there, and I don't want to divert from his original thing, but those are two things when you talked about community, how in my world race would come up. And go ahead. I'm sorry.
Yeah. No. I think what you brought up is amazing because I got two things. One real quick. I got pulled over in Charlotte, North Carolina, bro. I was flying. I was going 95, and as a white man with a decent car and a license, like, dude, those thoughts never enter my mind, never. And that's just what it is, I guess. And that's sad to me. But like when you were talking about being pulled over, what goes through your mind? I think everyone just needs to kind of just hear that. I maybe that's all I have to say on that because it's very different. But I want to come back to community for 1 second, and I want to just propose something. A thought, and that's that when you look at these horrendous, disgusting, the scourge, I think, of this nation, which is, I believe the statistic is there's over 320 school massacres a year now, school shootings. And I believe Columbine is what kicked it off, kind of, for the most part. And if you look at the time at which technology segmented us into digital communities and away from physical communities, you know, because when we all grew up, we were playing outside with our buddies, you know, and our moms would call us in for dinner or whatever. We'd be playing basketball, playing football till the sun went down. I think there's an eerie similarity in timing between the segmentation of technology and all of a sudden people feeling so separated that these massacres are happening. And I would just love to hear what you guys have to say on that.
I think technology just exposed that even more so, John. I think that a lot of these, let's call it kids that have problems that have ended up doing these type of things. What my point is that they were probably already having issues, but I think the isolation with the technology on top of it probably compounded it more. Mm-hmm. I think it was already probably a problem. I think that now the way that things operate, because I look at it like this, I never really played a lot of video games growing up, but I had friends that did play Nintendo and Sega and all that kind of stuff that did still kind of play outside, but still was probably more on video games than regular TV. I really think about it like this. If you combine the time that, and I'm sure all of us had homies that did this, that where they were like playing video games and they was watching their shows, I'm not so sure. This is just, I'm just posing the thing that it's that much different than the kids on their phone. They're just spending their time on a different computer, on a different TV. I think that to Maurice's point, I've also seen that in my house where, you know, obviously a lot of my job is on social media interacting, then kids playing a video game and somebody's doing something. And before you know it, all five people are on their phone. And you're like, well, how did we get to this point? So I really think,
well, I think it's very different, Corey, because when you had Atari and Nintendo, that when Maurice described his household being, he's on his phone, his woman's on his phone, his daughter is on her mm-hmm. phone. That's because we have created social, right? Social used to be people. So even if you were playing with your homies, if you were playing video games, right? You were playing your buddy in Madden, right? So you were sitting next to another human being and you were talking and looking at another. I don't think it's video games, dude. I think it's the social component. Now it is fully acceptable to be a social individual, not in person, online.
Yeah, no,
you be social.
I just think
then
it's
you take a fake persona.
I'm not saying that it's right. I'm just saying it's happened and it ain't coming back. Yeah. I don't think so. You got to be conscious of it so you don't get down the rabbit hole too far, right? Which, you know, we're no devices at dinner, and we try to, like, you know, limit it to times. And, you know, then I get coupled in that too. Ray's like, no one's in devices. What are you doing? I'm like, well, I'm like fucking working still. So, like, you know, the difference between my kids looking at or playing a video game and me posting about our business is two different things, right? So what I got to do is also make sure that I'm in, like, when that shit's going on, that's the only thing I'm doing. I'm not just scrolling for no reason or doing whatever. So I think that, you know, those are things that I would say put in the category of kind of bother me a little bit, that's where it's at. Dude, I wish it was like it used to be. I mean, the kids don't play, like, the neighborhood doesn't play games. It just doesn't happen that way anymore. It sucks. And, you know, but also I'm not so, like, clueless to think that I don't want to sound some old ass fogey, because that's how, you know, I've heard my parents talk about and their parents. This is just the way it is. It's just evolution. Whether we
but
like
dudes
it or not, that's
shot up at school, bro.
I'm not saying you're not right. I'm just saying that's just what we're dealing with. That's the reality of it. Maurice, let's go ahead if you want to comment on that, and then also just kind of go to your number one thing that's kind of bugging your ass. So go ahead.
Yeah, but about this school shooting deal. I've kind of looked at that school shooting deal, and I don't know. I'm going to speak to a segment of it, like. Part of the issue is, like, one, you want to make it aware that, you know, these school shootings are happening. But then I ask myself, and this is strictly from the copycat mentality. I ask myself, like, you know, for a kid who's disturbed or bothered and he sees the sort of reaction that is received from that, you know what I'm saying? And he looks at it like from a glorification standpoint, like, oh, if I'm mad and I get pissed off, this is how I get people's attention. I just shoot the fucking school up. You know what I'm saying? And I asked myself, like, long time ago, like, you know, does that encourage the kid who feels similar to the kid who just walks inside the fucking movie theater or walks inside the school and shoot the whole cafeteria up? Did that plant an idea for kids who are basically going through some sort of social or emotional disturbance inside of school? And so I think, like, when you put that shit on the news and the media, I think you have to, just to kind of show where people at. But I'm not so sure that it didn't encourage, you know, more of these kids to be like, fuck it. You know, if kids getting on my fucking nerves, this kid's bullying me, you know, I'm going to go ahead and get, you know, X gun and bring it and just fuck everybody up. And, you know, I don't know. And just even talk, like, it just even sounds crazy, like school shooting all these fucking kids. That shit just sounds like fucking nuts to me. But, you know, very, very unfortunate. But I don't know. Like, I that was just my thoughts on. I wonder how was that a thing? But.
It's halftime, Johnny. I'm basically like Nas, so I'm gonna spit a rap for you. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Can you beatbox for me? A little louder. Come on. There it is. All right. So Boston Sword and Tuna, Mikey Scola. He got, okay, I can't do it. That was, I liked your beatboxes better though. So anyway, Mike Scola,
come on,
Boston,
man.
Sword and Tuna. I was fronting, bro. I got no rap skills at all. Bro. I was straight fronting. So, but who's not fronting is Mike Scola, because he dives into the sea. He takes swordfish, shrimp, lobster, salmon, scallops, halibut, all on head on, throws them in the boat so he can deliver it straight to your door, sometimes by the next day, by 10:30 in the morning, shop.bstseafood.com. If you want 15% off, and I know you do, use BIZBIS15. What do you think, John?
I think you forgot to tell everybody that before Mike throws the lobster, the flounder, the salmon, the crab, all that stuff, that he does skull crushers with the only the heaviest of the fish, and then he throws them out of the water. So that's a very important part of the process. Skull crushers. Because when you're doing skull crushers 2,000 feet under the sea, first off, there's a lot of pressure, and it's amazing that his body doesn't explode, right? There's a lot of pressure. Number two, to have the strength to be able to throw those out of the water from that far down, I mean, our man's got some skills.
Mike Scola is so respected underneath the sea, he only dates mermaids. Did you know
that? Dude, under the sea? Remember that song from the Disney movie? I don't know which one it was.
Only dates mermaids.
Yeah.
Yeah, the hottest ones. Mermaids, so,
bro. He dated mermaids.
I'm just saying, folklore. Folklore, that's what it is. It's a true statement, though. Hey, only dates mermaids.
Be in the next
only
Avengers
gets the best
movie.
Seafood.
We're going to get him casted. Next Avengers movie.
Make sure you guys check out Mike. He's been with us forever. Shop.bstseafood.com. Boston Sword and Tuna. Give you 15% off. BIZBIS15 off all your East Coast fresh seafood. Delivered straight to your door. John, riff on 2020. Tell them about a dream you had about getting photo shoots, oiled up. They're on all these websites or something like that, I think.
So I woke up and I was being transported on like a gurney, kind of like, you know, what they do at the hospital, right? But they were taking me to the beach, and they were like, you know, when we think about beach bodies, we think about yours. And I said, well, who are you guys? They said, well, we're the best photographers in the world and we need to shoot a beach body. I said, okay, absolutely. I understand that. I looked in the mirror this morning. I saw this beach body. They started taking pictures of me, and they said, you know, what we do with these pictures is, because there's so many health, nutrition, food, fitness websites, people need perfect bodies and photos of perfect bodies for their website, right? They need to build that, right? It helps them sell their product. It makes food look healthier. It makes supplements look stronger. It makes all the other nutrition and vitamin products look more effective. So we need a perfect body. And I was like, fine, do whatever you got to do. So they did a photo shoot of me. And now I think after my photos were taken to 2020, over 4 million or like 4.2 million businesses bought my photos on TWENTY20.com. And a lot of photographers got rich, specifically the one that shot my photo shoot. So
I love
that. Those are the kind of things that happen at 2020.com, Corey.
Well, I'm going to tell you my experience, John. So it does have something to do with you, too. I don't know if you're ready for this. Okay. This might make you feel a little weird. I went to 2020.com, TWENTY20.com/biceps. I was getting my 5-photo free trial, and I was starting the site.
Corey,
Wiener Dog, BigWiener.com. Okay. And there was 5 photos of Bam, your wiener dog, on there, John, that you must have uploaded.
Genetics.
And it has nothing to do with you because he's a dog, so it's not your genetics. But I was able to get 5 photos of Bam that has the biggest wiener on the planet for my website, wiener dog, bigwiener.com.
Well, listen, Bam is right next to me, and all he's doing, he's looking at me, and he's just nodding his head like, that's right. So, yeah, I must have.
5-photo free trial at 2020.com/biceps, TWENTY20.com/biceps. John, tell them about Podcast Influencer, and we'll get out of here.
Yeah, man. Well, like you guys have been hearing so far in this episode, we got a lot to say. We got a lot to say about a lot of different things. And what's amazing about podcasting is it gives everybody a voice. You don't need to be signed on by CBS, ABC, ESPN. You can create your own show about what you want to talk about your niche. You could build a community. You could build a following. You could produce content. And it's fun, right? Because you're expressing yourself. So podcastinfluencer.com is a place to assist people who either A, have podcasts and they want more attention to be put on their podcast, because podcasting is fairly young, right? It's hard to understand how to effectively market your podcast. And what I can promise you is that at podcastinfluencer.com, we have the answer to podcast marketing, period. Reach out to us. But if you're starting a podcast, we can also guide you in the right direction. And we have learned from our mistakes and we have the playbook. We have the blueprint on how to go into the podcasting business, because here's another thing. Money is flooding into it as well, because sponsors know that listeners of podcasts are very loyal, Corey Gregory. So that is podcast.
No, it's awesome. It's a lot.
It's a special place.
Yeah, I didn't mean to cut you off. Basically, it's a huge marketplace. We've experienced great success in it. We have a lot of fun with it. This is our way to kind of put our skills once again to the test, Johnny and I together, and we'd love to help you out. So, John, I'm having a blast with this episode. I say we get back to it. Let's roll.
My personal deal, or I had two of them, and I just won't be long on them. But my personal deal, just like where I'm at in life, which seems to not frustrate me, but gets under my skin consistently, is the lack of a sense of urgency, just with people in general. And I guess, like, you know, I'm just like a highly motivated, highly urgent, highly, let's get this shit together. Let's get this going. Let's move. Let's make it shake. Let's make it happen. All these things that we're talking about. Let's not be meeting about meetings about meetings about meetings. Like, let's bring this shit to market. Let's make it happen. And just a collective sense of complacency, to where, you know, it's easy to talk about, you know, all of the things that you want to do or the business that you want to get done. But everybody moves in sort of a lackadaisical manner. And I guess, like, part of my soul is always searching for the guys who want to change the world, or the guys who really want to make something happen, or really like, hey, my motherfucker, I got up and I aimed for the fucking moon and I took action toward it every fucking day. And I'm urgent about it. And I want to go get it. And I want to get motivated. And I want to have my shit. And I want to do every fucking thing that's possible to be done to get that thing done. And I want to be special. And I want to make that shit happen. Like, you know, not finding that spirit or having it and wanting to be around it more. And I know it's not normal, but that thing just sort of frustrates me. And I don't know if you two have ever been working on an idea and you had it around you, but people just not really like, let's go. You know what I'm saying? So that's kind of like where I'm at. That's why I tell people 5:30 in the morning, hit me up. I'm taking meetings on the phone. Like, I'm telling you, to the point, this is a little bit too much information, but I literally take my phone in the shower and I'll return text messages in the shower and wipe the fucking phone off and set it on the rack and literally keep on going. And I go all day and all night. And just to have that spirit of like, I'm alive, motherfucker, I'm working on something, I'm going somewhere, the shit that we're doing will be something significant. Man, I just get excited talking about it. But, you know, when you have that shit, that's when you feel alive. It don't matter about no fucking money, nothing else. It's just that you're passionate about something. And that's kind of like, you know, what seems to bug me at this current moment in my life. And so I don't know if y'all have anything to say about it.
Oh, hell yeah. I can tell you this. So I experienced the same feelings. I still do to a certain extent, but because I experienced them in the past very heavily in some very specific situations, what I learned was on that tip, That's why so few people are successful, right? Because action is what's required, and action is change, and change scares people. So I stopped looking at it like, why can't people move at my speed? And I started looking at it, Maurice, like this. Wait a minute. This is my competitive advantage, because I'm willing to move at the speed of light. So if I'm willing to move at the speed of light and others are not, what does that say about my chances of being successful, right? I'm going to blow every vendor, every partner, everyone I ever do business with, I'm going to blow their minds, because I'm going to move at the speed. So that gives me a competitive advantage. So I don't want to say I stopped relying on people. I think I started thinking about people in a more systematic way. And I kind of implemented this thought. Okay, expect one thing per person, like one task. This person can do one thing. This person can do one thing. And when you start expecting less from people, and they deliver more, that's just a bonus. But at the end of the day, Mo, I believe it's a huge competitive advantage for success.
Johnny, I think you said it right, John. It's people that operate like we're talking about. It's all about expectation level. So here's the way I started looking at it. I don't expect anybody to be like me. I just don't. Now, if you work with me or alongside me or under me or however that is, I expect that I have a different expectation level. If you're like in the process of doing business with me or working, like there's a different expectation for you. Outside of that, I don't expect anything from it. I try not to. I've had to work on this. Like when I think something should be a certain way, and it really doesn't like, you know, hinder me if it doesn't, if it's not a certain way, like it does, I don't have no business with this person. I don't expect hardly any, because I just realized that I operate good, bad, or indifferent. I don't think I'm no better than it, but I operate completely different than what most people can even like conceptualize. And that what my action and what they believe is action and is two different things. And I realized that a long ass time ago that I was kind of operating on my own for a really, really long time. And so I just started to have different expectations for people from people that I just know compared to people that I actually like deal with and work with. I do have a different set of expectations for people that are in the area of what we do, Johnny, at different businesses or what I do on my stuff. It's like that has a different expectation to it.
Yeah.
And it needs to be met if you want to fuck with me. But outside of that, I started having less expectations for other people. I think I used to keep people that aren't in my circle of work at the same expectation level. And that's wrong, because you're going to get let down like fucking constantly.
Sure.
Constantly.
Because most people, I believe, real quick, most people, I believe when it comes to work, I think they have the have to mentality. Oh shit, I have to do this. They don't have the want to mentality. When you have the want to mentality, I want to do this pertaining to work, you're not doing it because it's 9 a.m. You just punched the motherfucking clock and your boss is going to yell at you if you don't do it. You're doing it because you're like on fire to attack the day and to go after a higher level of success. So the have to mentality versus the want to mentality are two different things. And the people who are very successful, they live in the want to.
I'll tell you like this. You're definitely fucking right. I'll tell this to the listeners, man. When you get to the point where like nothing matters, but just being like, are having supreme execution with what you have going on, and it becomes just more about just executing everything very fucking well, like that's when life gets fun. But then also when you're engaged in something and you're not just trying to do just enough, right? I think that mentality gets me frustrated to like the people who just like, oh, let me just do enough. Like that just doesn't make anybody special. Like I don't know how you can get up and be involved in something, be with the company, whether you fucking bagging sacks or whether you fucking sending emails out to people and not like search for a sense of perfection with what you're doing, just to search for that sense of perfection and just your approach to what you do, how you do what you do. And like, that's what it is. Just trying to be like, come a supreme, so professional, and you get better from operating, Corey. Like, you know what, Corey? And you said something like, no, motherfucker, I don't think I'm better than you, but I operate better than you. You know what I'm saying? I operate like a fucking professional. No, it's better. It ain't different. It's fucking better. Like, call it what it is, right? And so sometimes you got to just tell people hard truths. Like, you operate like a rookie. I operate like a pro. And there's different, like, there's different rewards, and there's different consequences from operating the way we do. Like, when you operate slow and low, you don't get shit from it. You operate at a high level. You deliver consistent. You own your shit consistent. You plan your schedule. You motoring through the shit. You're highly motivated. You have good energy. You're a good person to be around. You got a good spirit. You're always doing more than what you paid for. You always talk about what's next. You always talking about how you solve problems. When you start talking about that shit and you do it consistently and you're delivering more solutions than motherfucking excuses, brother, that's how shit gets done. That's how you become special. That's how you become, that's how you become a fucking household name. And it doesn't matter what you're doing. We can fucking start a fucking picture frame company, but if we just deliver and execute very high, I just looked at a picture frame, so I thought about it, but that's the beauty of life, like taking my skills and focusing on something, no matter what they are, and said, okay, since I'm focused on this, and since, like, you know, I have breath in my fucking lungs and I can breathe and I can focus and I can articulate and I can put something into something, I'm putting my fucking energy into this deal and I'm giving it every motherfucking thing I got because that's me and I give everything I got to shit. You know what I'm saying? And when you pour into that shit and then that becomes a part of your personality, that's that. Dude, I'm getting excited because that's life right there. That's fucking life. When I'm putting something into something, I'm putting my energy, my life, my human being, my fucking soul, my spirit, and I'm going to grow this thing. And to do it, I don't, listen to me, I'm getting excited even fucking thinking about it. You know what I'm saying?
Because it's so fucking valid because what you just said about I operate this way versus, let's say, having skill or being good. The way I operate is more important. And it absolutely is. And it's just like, think about a little guy like Wes Welker and how much energy that dude puts on when he steps on the football field. And think about some 6'3" freak who's got all the skills, who just jogs, right? Wes Welker is going to be known with Super Bowl rings because dude's got very, very little skill, but he just fucking plays his fucking balls off. He gives everything he's got when he's in that moment. When it's game time, it's 120% or zero. There is no jogging. There is no give me a water break. It's fucking full steam ahead. That's why people are going to remember Wes Welker's name over Dez Bryant's name. Let me tell you, straight up.
No, listen to me. To add on to that, right? We need to quit lying to fucking people like there is another way, right? The way is the fucking way.
Like, let them know, Mo. Let them know.
Motherfucker, listen to me. There's like get rich quick schemes and successful schemes. That shit, easy come, easy go. It's the dope man theory.
Yep.
Dude, man, listen to me. As long as I've been fucking living and looking at people, there's no other way. The price you pay and the sacrifices you make to be elite or to be known or to be great or to be significant within the games that we play in the game of life, there's no fucking shortcuts, my man. Like, you have flash in the pan dudes, whether it be fitness, business, whatever. But the guys who last a long time are the guys who get up, work their ass off, perfect their craft, develop their craft, continue to learn and work at a high fucking level every day. Now, do you lose personal time in your regular life? Absolutely. But that's the trade-off. You're trading off the personal time and the personal comforts that everyone enjoys to be significant in a space and to live above average, to operate above average, to give to others above average, to be a leader in certain spaces. And that's what it is. Like, people like, you know, is there not, Maurice, how do I get better at playing football? I get this question all the time. Like, dudes, they hit me in a DM. Go lift weights, go watch film, understand the game. Okay, so how do I get better? Go lift weights, go watch film, like, go do your skill drills. Okay, how do I get better? Motherfucker, it's that simple. You know what I'm saying? And you do it repeatedly.
But Mo, do you think it breaks down to this? Like you got it, like from the most simple standpoint, you have to want it more than anything and be willing to sacrifice everything for what you want. Because I think it starts there, right? It's got to start there.
So I give you the downside of technology. Technology, and maybe I'm right, maybe I'm wrong. I don't believe in right or wrong, to be honest with you. I just believe everything is what it is, but I'll just state it like this, right? So technology, I guess, sometimes gives people too many options, right? So we've come to the society like, oh, I'll do this, and if this doesn't work out, I'll try this, and if this doesn't work out, I'll try this, and if that doesn't work out, I'll try this, right? And I think that actually hinders a person, right? And I'm not saying that, you know, be foolish and not, you know, keep your mind open to other activities, but the lack of commitment and the lack of the lack of vision and lack of commitment basically results into the inaction or the lack of sense of urgency for something. That's my thing. I don't think that we in this culture just not committed to anything. I don't think that if you look all the way across the board, if you look across social media, if you look at people, just commitment is not a thing. And so when you're not committed, you're just not fucking all in. So if I was really saying something like, Reese, what are you really saying? I just feel like the lack of commitment is what produces people not to have a sense of urgency towards anything. And I think like, you know, growing up in a space, and I hate to have all this old school talk, that when you were committed to shit and you all in with shit, man, you just get different results. And so like, if anything, man, I don't care what you're in. Like, sometimes it's cool to shut the blinders down in different areas. Like, I had, listen to me, and Corey noticed, right? I had transportation. I was up rocking and rolling. I was making, you know, mid six figures with transportation. I literally shut transportation down and literally shut it all the way down. And I went all in with the red zone. Shut a whole company down that I could have got up every day, worked till about 8 o'clock, collected six figures, came home and did this. But you know what? I said, fuck this. This is taking my energy away from what I really should be doing. Now, I've acquired a bunch of skills from that, but I would get more return on my investment if I just focus all of my energy on this. And what comes from this comes from this. But it was I took the choice and I made myself be committed to one thing. And I added a sense of urgency and I dug and I continue to dig. Because I know if I just pour myself all into this and I have a sense of urgency and I figure problems out as I go, this thing can be great for me and great for a bunch of people. And so that's my little rant and rave and all that shit. So that's all I have, Corey.
I'm saying if you want something so bad, yeah, it was good, Reese, and it makes a fuck ton of sense, and I think everyone needs to hear it. If you want something so bad that no matter if your mother, your brother, your sister, your friend, Maurice Claret, John Fosco, Corey Gregory cannot talk you out of it because you know in your gut, I want this so bad. You got your winner, buddy. You got your fucking winner. That's your path. Go after that shit. But you have to want something that bad to be successful at it, period. If you don't want it that bad, it ain't going to work.
I want to kind of piggyback off that real quick, John. So I had a family event this last weekend where my grandparents celebrated their 70th wedding anniversary, which is unheard of in today's day. They're both 91, right? So there's 200 people there, friends, family, all kinds of stuff. Some people I ain't seen in a while. Some people that absolutely are not on social media, but try to keep up with me, you know, through asking my mom or doing whatever. Got to see my godfather I ain't seen in a minute. He's 87. My man's name is King O'Toole. Now I don't care how you get, you can't get any more gangster than your name's King. And you're so Irish that your last name's O'Toole. So I saw my man King, which was awesome. He was showing me love, which was cool. But I saw a friend of the family I ain't seen in a long time, and they said to me, you know, we hear some stuff, we got some questions, we want to ask you about how you're doing, and they want to ask about Arnold and all these different things, right? And supplements. And they said, here's what we know: you've never changed your dialogue ever since you was a kid. Like, we remember when you left, you talked about lifting weights. They felt the same spirit on me 20 years later, because I knew so well that the area, because I could have never detailed it. And so like when what I'm trying to get to is as a listener is that you just got to know the interest level. Like, my interest was only in this. I couldn't have told you whether I was going to be a trainer of the stars, or I was going to be in supplements, or I was going to be here talking to you in media at Business and Biceps. I couldn't have told you that, right? But what I could have told you is that this is all I like to do. no one gave me a defined way to do it. But with the urgency and with the action, that's what I, you know, employed into the world and moved where I needed to do and did what I need and worked and sacrificed. And like the body of work of not seeing people for a really long period of time and them still kind of relaying that to me, they didn't even realize what they were doing for me, but they were just kind of saying like what they had observed. And they're just friends of the family. They're not family actually, but you know, they had a son or a daughter that was the same age as me. So they watched me grow up. And it was just really cool to hear that back this weekend and just to see the family members kind of showing love and asking questions and genuinely excited because they understand, because they know me since I was so young. So that was just a cool experience this week of them people like kind of just showing me love and in a really like honest way. So I just want to kind of share that.
What you mad about, Corey?
I'm not mad, baby. Oh, what am I bad? Okay. Yeah. So after that. So, all right. So I was excited about that. What I'm mad about, and I have been for a while, is kind of, and I was mad that I was like this, and I think I figured it out, but is entitlement in general. I think that kind of based off kind of some things that Maurice talked about with lack of with complacency and sense of urgency. I think compiled with that, you really get fucked up if you got entitlement on top of it. And a lot of those things kind of go hand in hand. And I think that a couple things I want to touch on. My business didn't open up fully until I had no entitlement, sense of entitlement. That I remember it plain as day. I've talked about it multiple times. When I quit worrying about that, and then Maurice had another set of advice he had given me much later about counting other, you know, people's money or being upset. Like there was certain things that I've went through personally that opened up my business to a new stratosphere. And it all had to be based around entitlement. And what I can tell you if you're listening right now is that if you think that you are owed anything, you're limiting yourself forever, because no one owes you fucking dick. Straight up. And when you think that, you know, you hating on this person because they're getting that or that, like if you bring any of that into your life, you're fucked. And it is the honest truth. When I quit worrying about other motherfuckers and when I quit worrying about why it hasn't happened yet, because I hadn't put in enough time or sacrifice for it to happen. Because guess what? It happens when the fuck it's going to happen. You cannot control it except for every day, get up and have action and bust your ass and go after what you really want and who this person you think you can be one day. But there's no specific like thing that you're owed. And I think that people I've operated with, when they act like, why ain't you doing this for me? Like the sacrifice that I gave and did all these things was for them. Well, fuck you guys. Cause it wasn't. It was for my family. You're not owed shit. It's just straight up. Yeah. Like I didn't do all this for because you think I'm supposed to put you on. Because like, no, fuck you. Like it's just, that ain't how it works. And so like, I think that the thing I'm pissed off about is just cause, and I've had talks with a lot of people that I help, like, yo, you're not entitled to one fucking piece of content on my shit. You're not entitled to me to do anything for you. If I'm going out of my way to help you, because we don't do business, like I'm mentoring you, it's because I want to see you be successful. If you misconstrue that my help benefited me in a more, it's all based, like, I don't want to say I'm still trying to push my career and our stuff to the next level, but to a central point, I have far surpassed what I ever thought was possible for myself and my business. No question. Every day I have an unbelievable amount of gratitude, but just because I was able to get it there with help from many people, it doesn't mean that you're entitled to any of it, not you metaphorically, but just people in general. And it's like, that's one thing that really is I'm mad about, is because when people act like that with me, I really want to fucking slap them, to be honest with you, and say like, it ain't there yet. And because I'm there doesn't mean you're there. You know what I'm saying? And that's one thing that, you know, because I feel like I'm still sacrificing every day to get what I want for my family and our business. And that's not stopping because of what level that I'm in theory think I'm at. Like, I just don't think it's never enough. I'm always pushing. And it's like the consistency of that push is why what's happening is happening. I don't know. That's some shit that just fucking bugs the fuck out of me.
Well, yeah, it sounds like there's been some events that have got under your skin. And over my career,
I've ran into it multiple times,
sure.
John.
And it makes sense. I think we all have, but I know you definitely have, especially, you know, recently. But it's like the one thing I like to say that just I know it may be general, but once people can grasp that success and getting what you want in life literally starts and ends with you, and it starts and ends with you. Like, repeat that back to yourself, listener. Like, my success and where I go in life starts and ends with me, and any help I get along the way is a bonus. Anybody that wants to give me 5 minutes of their time is a bonus. If you expect to handle your business by yourself and you're on your own mission and there's people along the way that assist you, that is a bonus. But you are on this path to your success. It's yours. So you must take ownership of it and not expect things from people. So when they come to you, appreciate them, grab the knowledge, learn, and keep going down your path. But like Cory said, you ain't entitled to a damn thing from anybody. And if you go into your journey expecting that, like, hey, it starts and ends with me. Oh, he helped me? Cool. You are upping your probability for success, simply put.
What you got about that, Mo?
I didn't realize I had my phone on mute. I was talking. I wasn't hearing shit.
Yeah, go ahead, buddy.
Yeah, what I said was that we could probably do an entire podcast on people who feel entitled. And what I want to say and will say is this 100%. Like, John hit the nose on the head. Like, nobody owes you shit, right? And the second part of that is quit counting the next motherfucker's money. People feel entitled when they feel like the next motherfucker.
Amen, Maurice Claret. Amen.
Man, listen to me. You feel like the next motherfucker getting dough, you should be a part of it. And that should be your deal. And you start feeling like you need to be in the next person's space, right? And for the people who do that, let me remind you something, or let me tell you about something. You think you're just like a motherfucker in the streets. That's the nature of how people get robbed, or how they start robbing people. In corporate America, motherfuckers start hating and they start doing sneaky shit to take your money. And the streets, motherfuckers just pull guns on you. So, right? The reason I get mad at motherfuckers in corporate America, I say, y'all motherfuckers hate people in the streets, but y'all think and do the same shit. You just have different tactics about doing it. You know, in the hood, it's barbaric. In the corporate world, it's like little tactics and sneaky shit and all type of other bullshit. But I'll put that on there. But the bottom line is nobody owes nobody shit but respect and love. And when you start there and end there and realize that that's all people owe each other and you operate from that perspective, then everything becomes easier. And my biggest takeaway with this, Cory, and I keep on telling you this, and it's always this, do not sit and count another person's money. When you sit and count another person's money, you will do nothing but make yourself fucking frustrated. And their money becomes your focal point, and why you don't have it becomes your focal point. And everything you're doing is measured on how much is he making and how much I'm making. And I'll tell you all again, just like I did at Business and Biceps, I have never once said, what are you getting? What are you getting? It ain't none of my motherfucking business. Oh, that's what I get? Cool. Let's keep on rocking and rolling. And when you start to operate like that and you realize, okay, if you want more, drive more motherfucking value, right? And then they'll say, okay, I got to pay you more because you're worth more. You know what I'm saying? And I'm talking, but I'm talking about real life shit. This is my real reality. You know what I'm saying? Not just in this, but in other stuff that I do. But when it comes down to let me add value to something and let me be so ingrained in something that if I wasn't a part of this thing, it wouldn't happen. That's how you drive your conversation. If you want to drive your conversation, drive your money, start taking more responsibilities for motherfuckers, right? And when you start taking five motherfuckers' jobs and you make them your one and you execute at a high level, motherfucker gonna be like, man, I gotta keep this dude around. I gotta keep this girl around. That's how shit happens, right? But when you sit back and just be a jealous and envious motherfucker and look at the next person and be like, he got that, I ain't got that, I should have that. Oh, man, that's some hater shit. You're a fucking hater. I tell you that shit. And that's what it
is. Yeah, you're replaceable in every way. You're replaceable in every fucking way if you have that fucking attitude.
Yeah, you just know you're a hater. Listen to me. You call them like they are. Like, let's use, because these motherfuckers young enough to understand this shit. If you act like that, operate like that, you, like, for like this, you're a fucking hater. You're a fucking jealous motherfucker, and nothing good comes from that space.
Hey, I used to, after Maurice told me that years ago, and it helped me a ton. Not that I did that a lot, but I was just doing it just enough to hold me back, I think. And not even knowing, so it was like subconscious, right? So intentionally, I started like kind of operating a little differently. And then when I would compliment somebody, like if somebody would say, like, even if they was gloating, oh yeah, man, I'm killing it, man. The company did 12 million this year, blah, blah, blah. This is what I would always say, dude, awesome for you. And I was like, and I really mean that because I ain't a hater, man. I want to see people do well. And people would be like I would actually say that to them. Like, I'm not saying that because I'm like, and underneath my breath, I'm going like, man, fuck this dude. I'm really saying like, no, you're getting it. Cool. Fucking good for you, for real good for you. Like
that's how you open up for success, mm-hmm. though. Just think about the good things that came from that. You're opening up. It's okay for, like, Corey, it's okay for you to have millions. John, it's okay for you to have millions. It's okay for everybody. Like, that doesn't do, like, John having millions doesn't, no. Listen to me, John having more money than me doesn't, I don't give a fuck. Like, it does, like, you know, people.
Yeah, exactly. No, I don't give a fuck. Yeah, about anything, about money.
Yeah, it, like, but people got to get to that. But I mean, my fault, Cory. I didn't mean to cut you off, but like, it just, like, I thought of a scenario in my head that's probably not, like, that's probably not healthy to talk about on this podcast. Well, but shouldn't be. No.
But what it is, Reese, is it should never be what holds you back because of somebody you're looking at. Like, there can be aspirations. There can be things that you aspire to, but it should never be like you're never going to get ahead by wanting to hold somebody else back or mad because you ain't got it. Because they've probably sacrificed or did something that you just kind of, like my dude told me a long time ago when he could tell I was just pissed off because shit wasn't rocking. I said, dude, you're just getting paid what you're worth right now, whether you like that or not. It's the fucking truth.
So think about it like this, mm-hmm. as opposed to looking at people's money and being like, oh, they're killing it. Like, what about, like, damn, you're a fucking amazing decision maker. Like, fucking A. Like, show, like, teach me how to make decisions like you do. You're a fucking, like, that's what I get, like, higher on than money. Dude, money is money is fucking paper.
It's
dude.
The byproduct.
Money the byproduct. Is just as it's there. It'll come. But I want to know how a motherfucker can make a decision with the weight of the world on his shoulders and be dead on. Like, I want to learn that. Yep. So I'm envious of that in a good way. Teach me. You know what I'm saying?
Well, that's what you should be asking, not hating. You should be asking that person how they got there, not hating why you ain't there. I think that's the fucking moral of the story.
Let me say this to all the young guys, right? And I know we grew up in a generation where, like, more young guys are, like, super rich early, or they're successful, or at least they pose it on the internet. Like, just remember, your process is your process. Your development is your development. Your leading off, and I always like talk about like the fucking runway strip. Like, maybe your runway strip to build up to get your plane in the sky takes a little bit longer. But just because, you know, Joe Blow took off at 23 and such took off at 27, or Joe Blow took off at 31, if you 33, it don't matter. Like, I was fucking broke. I'm 34 now. I probably had money for like 3 years now. But when I got out of prison, I was broke. And so I got a lot of friends. One of them being LeBron, this motherfucker's killing it. You know, I got friends who play the NFL, they killing it. But, oh, well, that's their process. They followed a different process. They had different sets of circumstances. They had other things in their life that I didn't have, and they made them work. And so that's just like, to you, if you're in that process of making your thing take off, like, okay, cool for the next man. But thinking about the next man's pockets or thinking about how the next woman's pockets and what they're doing. They just had a different set of circumstances. And just like to what John and Corey said, instead of hating or instead of sitting on the sideline and asking how you do that, like, don't go around them and be sucking their dick or kissing their ass. Hey, how did you do that? Because I tell you what I've learned is that successful motherfuckers love to teach people. And the teaching is their way of, one, like, that's the humble brag. When successful motherfuckers start to teach you, they basically tell you, like, hey, motherfucker, I got it going on. I know I got it going on. I'm going to just teach you because I need to pass this shit on in some capacity. That's just been my personal experience of seeing people who are super successful, right? But that should be the focal point of shit. And if you want to get better, hit up successful people and quit hating, or just don't go around and be a motherfucking groupie. Don't be the dude who come to Max Effort and just have all the fucking pictures and like, yo, I'm in the building. Like, you know, be there, learn, take that shit, you know, and put that shit to use and make it work for you in your own life.
Yeah. Love it.
Love it. Good. Hey, I like how this thing started and then how it morphed all these. That's what's so good about the podcast, guys.
Hey, you know what? People are gonna hate me, but you know, part of being on this podcast is if you don't like me, it's cool.
Truthful.
It's
cool. Yeah. No, it's being truthful, man. Same with Mo too. Like, honestly, John, between your political stuff out the gate and Maurice, the talking about outrunning, like, it's so crazy to me. Like, I would never think that going out for a run.
Yeah.
Just would never think of it. That's something that, and you've had some crazy circumstances with the police and stuff in the past, so I could see some of the things and just what's happened in the culture in general. But it's like, man, it's crazy to me that I did have a similar thing when I was lunging at like 5 a.m, hoodied up, you know, black on black, everything. And I definitely look like people were looking at me kind of twisted going up my road that way. So I kind of feel you, but I just think things like this that we're able to voice is why we do this, the teaching in between it. And just want to just commend both you guys. Always bringing the realness, man. I fucking love it.
I guarantee you like this. I guarantee you can't find another podcast with a mixture of white and black dudes who talk like this. I guarantee you that shit.
No.
Listen to me. I can guarantee you it ain't a motherfucker in the world who's talking like this. Because, like, listen to me, Corey. This podcast, it won't be stopped because it got real shit. I fucked it up last week and I stopped it because I had some technical difficulties.
It's all right, though.
But
it's good, though. It's good.
It feels so fucking good. I tell you that.
No, it's legit. A couple things I want to share with the listeners real quick. This weekend, I watched Conor McGregor's documentary. I don't know if either of you guys have watched it. And I watched the David Letterman interview with Jay-Z. They're both on Netflix, and they were both highly motivational and real as a motherfucker. And so I just want to kind of pass that on. Like, I watched both of them on Saturday night, and I could barely fucking go to sleep. So I don't know if either of y'all watched either of those two.
Football thug piece of shit. I'm going to say that for the record. Habib will tear his fucking face off, that fucking pussy. But anyways, yeah, they were good.
Yes.
Well, I've watched the Jay-Z one, but I haven't watched the Conor McGregor one.
You gotta watch the Conor McGregor one.
Yeah, so I'll watch it. Is it a documentary?
Yeah, it's a documentary. I think it's really good. And so, I love John. But see,
see what Conor just did? You saw how he threw that shit and cut a guy's face open and hit a woman. I mean, there's women
I disagree with those actions.
So let me say like this, right?
I disagree with those actions.
When I seen that, though, I just thought, like I said, is that the result from a motherfucker just making like $150 million from a fight? You know what I'm saying? Like,
part of it.
Yeah, like when you want to come up and you know, you're super disciplined and, you know, you're super careful because you're trying to get your money, you're trying to get your place. I said, man, dude, the motherfucker, after you get $150 million, because, like, you know, that's kind of like sort of like Floydish. You know what I'm saying? Like, let me do what I want to, say what I want to. I got so much money. I don't have regard for the next motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? So I just asked myself from a psychological
standpoint.
There's got to be lines because here, Michael Chiesa, who's a great fighter, number 7th ranked lightweight in the world, got his face slashed open, 30 stitches. He had to be pulled off the Brooklyn card, which was huge, for any UFC fighter because this fucking thug piece of shit took a 100-pound dolly, threw it through a window. He sliced up Michael's face. I know Michael. He's a good guy. They pulled him off the card. They also pulled another guy off the card because his retina got torn. And Rose Namajunas, who went on Saturday night to defend her title, almost got her fucking head smashed in. So he's a fucking piece of shit.
Hold on. So I thought he – I didn't know. So
I want to clear the record as previous to that. I'm talking about the documentary. Yeah, that has anything to do with what Johnny's talking about.
So you and Corey are a little bit more in tune to UFC. Like, so I thought he was like getting mad at some random person and just threw the dolly through the joint because he was mad. I didn't realize all that stuff happened afterwards.
But it was, bro, all
that was after media
the
day. All the fighters who were fighting in 2 days at the Barclays Center on pay per view were in that box.
Oh, I didn't realize.
Yeah, so his other athletes. Yeah, the whole thing was pretty fucking stupid and shitty. No doubt about that. And he actually hurt people.
Well, he'll probably get charged with felonious assault with that shit.
Oh, he did. No question. He's getting sued by everybody. Yeah. They arrested him, $50,000 bail. You know, he had the world at his fingertips, and now his fan base is going to get sliced in half. And he's going to have to fight someone who literally wrestled a bear at 9 years old and won. That's a fact. I'm not kidding. So he's going to pay for what he did.
Oh, I ain't, so put like this. I'll keep it real with you. I know all that stuff happened. And like that puts shit into a different light. You know, I don't know. My man might need a little help.
I'm like, made some bad decisions. He made some bad decisions for sure. All right, so let's wrap this thing up. Guys, great job. Make sure you check out and support who's supporting you. shop.bstseafood.com. If you want to get 15% off, use the BIZBIS15 for that fresh East Coast seafood from our boy Mike Scola. Check out shop.bstseafood.com. Make sure you go over to 2020.com. That's TWENTY20.com. /biceps to get your 5-photo free trial. 350,000 photographers all have their stuff available there, so you ain't got to get yourself in trouble when you're building that website or putting together your branding. Make sure you check out maxeffortmuscle.com. Build a stack today and leave us a 5-star rating on iTunes. Subscribe. Tell all your friends to subscribe. We are currently number 7 on the business charts on all of iTunes. And leave us a comment. So maybe we'll send you a t-shirt. Send the comment to jeremy@businessandbiceps.com or tag us on social media. We appreciate you guys. For John Fosco and Maurice Claret, I'm Corey Gregory. Can the podcast be stopped?
The podcast
can't be stopped.